Good morning. My name is Ved Chirayath. Today I'll be talking to you about NemoNet. I am the director of the Lab for Advanced Sensing at NASA Silicon Valley, and I'm really excited to be here. Normally we're in San Francisco, but we get to come to New Orleans today. Today we'll talk about NemoNet, which is the neural network for global coral reef assessment that uses fluid lensing. So just to give you a heads up, my background is in astrophysics. I got moved into earth science because of a few simple facts. The first is that we really live in an unprecedented time. In 2017, this is the state of affairs. We've mapped more of Mars and the Moon combined than we have of our own ocean floor. This is really startling to me, and I didn't know this going into this field, and that's really why my lab focuses on new instrument development in the agency and new tool development. While we have not mapped the whole ocean floor, we have witnessed essentially the extinction of a global species. As an agency that is striving to look for life in other planets, this is really scary to me, that we have a species visible from orbit. This is a coral reef off the coast of Australia that is actually dying off, and dying off faster than a lot of the other ecosystems on our planet due to climate-related issues. So why is it so difficult to study these systems? Why is it so difficult to map the ocean? Well, the first is something that actually Dong alluded to in the last talk, and that's that there's very little light that we have to work with. When you get down to the Earth's surface, there's a very few windows in the electromagnetic spectrum that you can see. And then in water, this is further compounded because the sliver of visible light that goes through gets absorbed very quickly. So as you get deeper in the water column, you get more and more absorption. This is typically why our satellite systems can only see the first 30 meters of the water column. The second issue is something that you should be very familiar with if you've gone swimming or you took high school physics, and that's refraction. You'd be surprised to know that in 2017, this effect, ocean wave refraction, is something we do not correct for in any satellite remote sensing, airborne remote sensing, or even UAV-based sensing. So if you stand above a pool with a camera, you're going to have refractive distortions. And the problem with this is if you're trying to study an ecosystem, a life form that lives on a scale of a centimeter, grows around a centimeter per year, you have no sensitivity to change in that ecosystem if your view looks like this. Ocean waves become a significant problem once you get to the 5 meter scale and finer, and there has to be some sort of technology that can deal with the refractive distortions that you see there. So that's where I focused my doctoral work, and I developed an algorithm called fluid lensing. The result of this is that when you have low resolution, the impact on how you assess the ecosystem, so for land, think of NDVI, the amount of cover of vegetation you have. For coral reefs, the simple question of where are the coral and what are they doing, we really cannot answer right now to high accuracy. In fact, if we use Landsat data, which is around actually 30 meter resolution, you'll notice that the error in just assessing the percent cover of coral grows to about 35 to 40%. That's really a dangerous error. If you were an astronaut and I told you that your oxygen supply was a certain amount to that error, you would not be comfortable going on a spacewalk. This should be a similarly alarming statistic for if you're dependent upon an ocean ecosystem for your oxygen and food produce, as well as shelter. So I studied this really carefully, the phenomena of what goes on with the water and light. And actually, we have a supercomputer at NASA Ames that's the 12th largest in the world that helps study this. So this is a full physics simulation of a test pool. And here you'll notice all these different phenomena kind of working together. You have waves causing refractive distortions, and you also have water causing absorption with depth. So as you get deeper in the water column, this is around 5 meters depth, you'll notice that this coral test target is significantly darker. The other thing you'll notice if you slow down the slide is that there are moments when these waves pass over an object where they magnify the object, and they also demagnify the object. That, to me, was really interesting and something that the algorithm exploits. So every time there's a magnification event, so you'll notice this test target here getting magnified temporarily, the algorithm is smart enough to pick out every positive magnification event. And then the second thing we do to deal with the absorption is track these bright bands of light called caustics. So those bands of light actually can be 100 times the intensity of sunlight above the sea level, which is really interesting to me. And you can use that as sort of a torchlight to light up the benthic surface and get very deep in the water column. So those two challenges I talked about, absorption and refraction, you can actually use to your advantage to image things at very high resolution. And that's what we've been doing for the last 4 years in my lab, is developing an instrument called FluidCam, and this was funded by the Earth Science Technology Office that has a number of CubeSats over there. And what this instrument does is it flies on a drone and hopefully in the future in space, and tries to solve this problem, where we have a fluid picture like this, and right now we do this, which is to take an integration over time, or take a mean image. The fluid lensing result, you'll notice on the bottom right there, not only resolves the target's geometry correctly, but can also improve upon the signal-to-noise ratio, or essentially the brightness and contrast of the image. So if you look at this flat fluid scenario, you'll notice that it's got the correct geometry, but it's significantly darker than if we drained the ocean of all the water, which is not going to happen anytime soon, nor would we want it to happen. So how have we been using this? Well, in 2016, we did a field campaign to an American Samoa, and here there's a beautiful fringing coral reef system. And the view from the aircraft looks like this. You have a lot of refraction, reflection, and absorption. So you have a lot of specular glare as well. And this is the 3D fluid lensing picture. So to me, this is really cool. I mean, this is like traveling on a different planet. Avatar has nothing compared to just what our own backyard has. And we really just mapped a sliver of this. You'll notice there's a sea cucumber that pops up here. This is about this big for scale. So this is currently the highest resolution benthic map ever produced from an airborne or a remote sensing platform. And this has a resolution of roughly half a centimeter. So this is very pretty imagery. And I have stared at this all day. Yes. The problem, however, is when you have all that data, you could train lots of graduate students to go through it and classify living coral or not. But really, the smart thing to do would be to do what your brain does, which is train a neural network to identify that coral. So this is our latest project, and we're actually going to be really unveiling this at Ocean Sciences. So if you come in February to Portland, I'll give 5 talks on this. NemoNet specifically uses fluid lensing to augment and study coral reef systems. So we'll give a little preview today, but this is essentially the first global coral reef assessment using half a centimeter data, augmenting satellite data. The main goals of NemoNet are just first, develop the most accurate algorithm for identification of coral organisms. All this terrestrial ecosystem people here, if you raise your hand, anyone say terrestrial systems, usually outnumber the aquatic systems at these conferences. Although the Earth's surface, I would like to remind you, is 71% water, and the rest is land. So we really need to develop better algorithms for ocean systems. We also want to study corals at the finest scale possible. So in a lot of cases, we're going to go down to the species level where we have centimeter data and where we have satellite augmented data. We're going to try to just tell you, is it coral or is it something else? Which is, again, a question we can't really answer right now. So one thing you might be asking yourself is, all right, it's great to have this airborne remote sensing technology to sample at the centimeter scale, but how do you do that globally? How do you get all of the coral reefs in the world? And the answer is you really can't. As much as I would like to travel to all of these reef systems and map them, the reality is we're only going to be able to map 1 to 5% of them at that scale. We're already talking petabytes of data for just a small 10 square kilometer system. However, we have airborne data sets and satellite data sets from commercial instruments as well as Landsat that have good imagery. They just need to know what they're looking at. And that's where augmentation comes in. So actually, the chief architect of this is in the audience. He gave a talk yesterday, Dr. Alan Lee. And this is on augmented machine learning training. So we take these results from fluid lensing, which produce, again, centimeter scale maps, and use them to teach the low resolution algorithm what it's looking at. This allows us to, without having to launch a new satellite, take existing imagery and actually tell you quantitatively what a pixel is. Is it coral? Is it not coral? Is it a mounding coral? Or is it branching coral? This is something that really hasn't been done that much in ocean systems. For NemoNet, we're going to go really broad and wide. We're taking in all the data we can get. Again, this is running on the 12th largest supercomputer in the world. We're starting with the coarsest resolution is Landsat. We're going to be training that with Coral Prism, which is going on right, just ended the Coral Airborne campaign. There's also commercial imagery from QuickBird and WorldView 3 that are at the half meter to meter scale. And then we have fluid cam and MIDAR data at the 0.1 centimeter to 1 centimeter scale. And these are used to train all of these other data sets. So in one area of the world, you should be able to zoom in at the finest available scale and tell you what the coral distribution is. The really exciting thing is you will be able to participate in this. So starting next summer, you can download this app and start coloring. It's a three-dimensional app. It's going to actually be interactive. So you'll get a little tour by Sylvia Earle of the coral reef system. And then you'll be able to get in there and start classifying mounding and branching coral. If you're really bad at it, that's okay. The computer is smart enough to know, and it takes in your input, considers it, and then puts it aside. If you're very good at it, you will be training a global coral reef model. And this methodology can really be applied to every system that has 3D data available. So think of Mars data, hydrothermal vent system data, exploring other planets. We have a lot of partners that we're using to launch this product, and you'll also be able to view the results within the app. So to give you a preview in the past of how these algorithms work, this is the raw data coming in from the aircraft, the fluid lensed version. So this would be the 3D map that we work with at the finest scale. This is a very healthy Pierides coral. And then as the gentleman asked, we have a depth elevation model that we get from that map as well. In fact, this is slightly higher than just a DEM because we get full 3D structure. And those both were used to train an algorithm to do percent cover classification. This is actually down to about a 5% error. In the field, the state of the art is around 25 to 30% error. So that gives you an idea of what you can do at centimeter scale data. And we can also go down to the morphology scale. So this region that looks like Texas is a mounding coral, and you notice that it abuts right next to a branching coral. This may seem like a trivial classification, but if you're a physical oceanographer, this basic question of what is the roughness of a structure is very hard to determine just from satellite imagery alone. So you really need airborne sets to get at this scale to understand what their rugosity is. A preview of the deep neural network, as I'll show you next. And here we've done, 128 hidden layers. And this is essentially training a computer with lots of test samples, either coming from people playing the game or from people like me selecting patches manually in my office and feeding it. We train a GPU over a couple of days. And then it can identify those same structures like your brain might at a much higher accuracy. So this is that same map now classified with our prototype NemoNet classification. And you'll notice that towards the end of this animation, that accuracy approaches 95%. And this is for morphology classification, which is notoriously difficult to do. So that little Texas region over there, you'll notice is getting resolved pretty quickly. So if you come up after my talk, I'll give you a little demo of the prototype app. And we actually have our game developer in the audience here, Jarrett. He will be giving a poster tomorrow. I encourage you to look for it, called NemoNet. You'll be able to download this NASA app next summer onto your phone and iPad and start getting into the game of classifying coral. So thank you very much for your time. And please let me know if you have any questions.